thank you all so much for being here this morning. I'm very, very proud to represent Nikon as a Canadian ambassador. I'm one of six in Canada and the only woman. Wow, that was a standing applause on that one, right? Yay! Come on, girls, I'm looking at you. Thank you so much for coming out on this rainy day, and I hope you enjoy the show and get lots of information and spend lots of money, because that's really easy to do as I was walking through, right? Your eyes are just going everywhere. I'm just back from a grizzly bear trip. And it's the first time that I'm going to be revealing my photos in a presentation. I've been posting some on Instagram and Facebook, and I will go through my story of shooting in very, very difficult conditions with this amazing trip that I got to do in the Yukon. Just to give you a little bit of a background, I have a studio and gallery in Ottawa, and I've done four books, and the last two have been a children's book called Benanuki, Discover Polar Bears, and Art of Kaleidoscope, The People, Wildlife, and Ever-Changing Landscape. So that's been keeping me awfully busy and has connected me to the Arctic, so much so that I've been 36 times now in the last 8 years. So clearly I have a love for the Arctic. Has anyone been to the Arctic from here? It has a way of grabbing your soul, doesn't it? And I hope to enlighten you a little bit about what we have up in the Arctic as well, and share some of the stories behind the scenes of getting these images that I've been able to do in the most wonderful and beautiful places in the world. I do a lot of work for magazines. I'm a regular contributor to Photo News. It's a free magazine, and if you haven't got a subscription, I highly recommend it. Go online and sign up. Phil is here from Amplis, and it's a wonderful, very informative, highly equipment-driven magazine that will enlighten you for sure. I have the cover of the new Canadian Atlas, and so I do some work with Canadian Geographic, and I even have a plane tail. That's cool, isn't it? So you should have seen me. I was in Northwest Territories last year, and I got on the plane, and it was the one with my image. I got on that plane, I'm like, hey, this is my plane. Everyone's looking at me like, what? I have this image on the plane of a tail that's flying all over the Arctic. A lot of people ask me what companies I work for. I work as a resource photographer. A lot for Adventure Canada. They have supported me throughout my book endeavors and also with my not-for-profit Project North. And if you want to travel to the Arctic, I have a few pamphlets. A lot of questions come up about traveling. You're welcome. I only have a few, but you're welcome to grab one or go online and see their programs, which are pretty amazing. I've worked with Abercrombie & Kent, and I will be this year as well. And Frontiers North, I'm off to polar bears on Tuesday. So back from grizzly bears last week and on to polar bears next week. We're going down to the legendary Cape Churchill, and there's still spots available, I've been told, and Polar Sea Adventures. So if you want to check out any of the places that I visited or the companies I travel with, on my website, you'll find it under Travel and Adventures. A lot of times I'm asked the question of what kind of equipment that I use. Primarily right now, I'm using the D4S and the DA10. How many people here are Nikon users? Yay, look at that. I'm not going to ask any other questions. I also have my secondary camera, which is the A10. I switch off between the D4S and the A10 when I'm out in the field. I also have the 800 that I use in an underwater aquatica system, and I also have the 7000 that I like to bring along and do for video, or just to have as a nice little backup and be able to pull on that when and if I need it, which I did in this last trip. My lenses of choice, my favorite for landscape, 14-24. It's an amazing, beautiful, beautiful lens. The 24-70 or the 24-120. A lot of times when I'm shooting from the plane or in the communities, I love the 24-120. It gives me a little bit of a wide angle option. It just gives me a little bit more reach with the 120 than with the 70. The 70-200 is one of my favorite lenses. And I just started shooting with the 80 to 400. I do a lot of work in my kayak, I like the versatility in the small lens versus, you know, going into a kayak with a 200 to 400. It's a tad bit tricky. So it gives me some great options. And I've, of course, I love the 200 to 400. And I've been lucky enough to work with the 600 and just recently in this last trip, the 800. And I asked Mark to pull it out because it's such an impressive lens. And if you want to come have a look after, you're more than welcome. So those are my cameras and lenses of choice. As I mentioned, I just returned from Bear Cave Mountain. Does anyone know where Bear Cave Mountain is? Probably not. There's only four people allowed in at a time, and their season is really only 4 to 5 weeks. And it's high up in the Yukon, and it's the only place in the world that this happens, that these bears are eating and feeding on these chum salmon. It's a late run because the water never freezes. So the bears are in a hyperphagia, so they're chowing down on as much salmon as they can get before they go into hibernation. So probably about a week after we were there, they would have headed up into the caves that are surrounding this area. As I said, it's very exclusive. I mean, it's very difficult to get there. Traveling from Ottawa, it was 12 hours in the air. You go all the way up to Dawson and then take a two-hour helicopter ride up to Bear Cave Mountain. And I love talking about Canada because there's so much that I'm discovering that I never knew. And I love to tell Canadians what we have in this incredible country that we live in. Pretty remarkable place and a dream come true for me. I've been trying to go there for the last 3 years and I was able to do it this year. And it was one of those moments, you know, when a nice bear came up and I was photographing it with the 800 and I had this nice tight image, and it was one of those dreams that had come true for me, and it was just like I had to knock myself and say, you're doing it, and this is happening. Really, really incredible. So when I was told to go up, I was told I had a 70-pound limit, and that included clothes. Fortunately, they had boots for us up there, because if you get into those minus 100-degree boots, they're pretty heavy. But trying to pack, as we all know as photographers, is very, very difficult when you're flying and with the restrictions that the airplanes are holding on us. And even though you say you're a photographer or that you have equipment, they'll just go, yeah, yeah, yeah. And they don't really quite understand exactly the value of what you have in your bag. So I have to do a lot of sweet talking, and I decided that I wanted to bring three bodies. I obviously wanted the D4S and I wanted the A10, but I brought the 7000 to do some video work. Does anyone do video here? Amazing opportunity that we have now to switch off and be able to grab your DSLR and even shoot the video through a long lens. I love to come home and be able to show the photos, but also when you can show the video and put you there with me, it makes all the difference. So I had chosen to take the 800 with me, and I was told before I went, Paul Nicklin is as photographed here, and I said, I've got the 800, what do you think? And he said, oh, you might have too much lens. Maybe a 600 might be better. I get there and everyone said, oh, you have too much lens. You have too much lens. I was like, well, I got too much lens. I've used it before on Sable Island. I'll use it again and I'll see. And I'll let you know if I have too much lens. You should have seen these guys when I walked out with the tripod and the 800. They all just kind of went, hmm? It had only been, only one other person had brought up the 800. And so that I pack into a Pelican case and send on its way down below, which is always very, very scary. I am an NPS member, so I'm able to borrow this lens from Nikon, which I'm very thankful for because it's not in my pocketbook to be able to go out and purchase one of these lovely lenses. But I also took the 80 to 400 as my secondary lens. And then, of course, the 14 to 24 for the landscapes. But it was a real struggle because I wasn't sure if I should take the 200 to 400, if I, you know, had too much lens with the 800. Anyway, I decided on this magic combination, which worked really, really well for me. I use a Vanguard tripod, and it has these snow feet. I don't know if anybody uses those snow sand feet, and they're wonderful, especially in these difficult conditions. We were on mounds, and I actually even had to use a fish head for the bottom of my front tripod head. And the sand and the snow feet are very, very versatile, and they work fantastic in making sure that your tripod is nice and sturdy. So obviously, lots of supplies like battery chargers, batteries, lots of cards. I didn't find that. I only shot 5,000 images on this trip, which was kind of small numbers for me. But you were waiting for those opportunities to come to you. So it wasn't a heavy, heavy shooting trip, but you certainly had to make sure that your batteries were charged, kept them close to our bodies the whole time just because of the cold. We averaged about minus 14 during the day, and it went down to about minus 18, minus 20 at night. And then the last day that we were shooting, it was minus 21. And that was pretty intense because you're not moving very much. And when you're out there, your primary concern is, of course, to stay warm, because if you're not warm, and in Canada Goose or some kind of clothing, if you're not keeping yourself warm, you're in big doo-doo. So a friend of mine distributes these gloves, and one of the prime questions that I get is, how do you keep your hands warm? A lot of times I don't even like to wear gloves. I like to handle my camera. I'm sure you're all the same, or many of you. These are amazing gloves if you want to come up and have a look at, but they are like a hunter glove. So there's gloves underneath, and there's pockets for hand warmers, and they're really fantastic for quick versatility, for being able to take your fingers out and get the shot that you need without freezing your fingers. Because clearly that's an issue for most of us who are living in Canada and shooting out in the outdoors quite a bit. So that's my kit. And I think I was 75 pounds, but fortunately I went with a friend who didn't and wasn't a photographer and didn't have equipment. So it was awesome because I got to use some of her weight. It's always good to travel with a non-photographer, right? And then you can just distribute some of your stuff. So this was an image of one of the, oh my goodness, it just totally went out of my mind. It was a creek in the back, and there were four locations that we could choose from, and there were two other photographers. And it was, you know, a gamble, right? Where are they going to go? Are they going to go in the back slough? Are they going to be at the corner? Where are they going to arrive and show up? And on our first day, we went out to this back slough, and I had this little mound. It wasn't very big, and the tripod legs were at all different levels, and it had been iced over from the bears who had been eating the salmon, and there was, you know, fish guts and, like I said, a fish head that was great for, for the bottom of my tripod, and it was icy. And when the bears approached, or when there was a bear around, your primary thing to do is to not move and to stay still and be low. So we had to be on the ground most of the day. We had to stand up periodically just to move, to move our bodies. But most of the day we spent on the ground, low and without any movement. So when a bear came, the worst thing that you want to do is threaten the bear. So the bear leaves, or the bear decides to do something you don't want it to do. As I said, they're in hyperphagia, so they're working a lot to hunt and fish. So you got to be really worth it. And these bears are very habituated. And the owner of this company has worked these bears for a long time and know for 25 years. So they know, you know, the generations before the bears that we were looking at. So they were named. This is Sophie. Pretty remarkable landscape just to sit. But one of the things is that you wait for the bears to come to you. You wait for the action to come to you. You don't go chasing it. And I experienced this the first time in the Arctic, when you just stood there and you waited for the animals to come to you. And when you're an A-type personality, or you want to shoot and you want to be going, and you're there for only a week and you want the best possible images, you have to sit there in silence. So imagine two women were sitting there just looking and almost meditating in a way that you're just waiting for these animals to come to you. And they do. In the first couple of days, the owner was, or Phil, I'll say his name, Phil, he was like, well, just wait till Sophie comes and fishes right in front of you and she grabs a fish. And then he looks at me, he's like, then you're going to have too much lens. Okay. And I couldn't believe that it was going to happen because the bears had been off. This was shot with the 800. I was quite happy to have the 800 for that image. But then Sophie did come up to us. And she would walk along the shore. They knew exactly what she was going to do. She crossed this little pond. She jumped up onto a tiny little island. And then she stood there and she stared at us. And I couldn't believe I was maybe 8 feet from her. And very happy to have my 80 to 400 because I was able to switch off. And she was quite comfortable with us being able to move. One of the things you weren't able to do is when a big bear or a bear that they didn't know came around, you weren't allowed to take up your camera and put it down and look. Like once your camera was up in position, you were allowed to take photos, but you couldn't move. So that can be rather tricky when you're twerked this way, looking at a bear that way, and you're in Canada Goose, your hands are freezing, you haven't got the right protection on because nothing was happening, then all of a sudden it's there, and you're not able to move, which happened a couple of times. But she did get closer, and I was able to get some beautiful profile shots, and she got so close that this was taken at, I think, 85 millimeter. And so she was pretty relaxed with us, let's just say. And there was no fear. As I said, if you didn't move and if you stayed still, you were okay. And the guide was there with a gun. And to me, this has to be one of my favorite photos just because of the little lip down below. And it's like, you know, she has an expression that I think that makes you want to go in and find out where she was, what she was thinking, a little bit more. I think it shows her personality a little bit more as well. So this was, she was looking at us, and then Phil said, she's going to jump that little island, get your camera ready. And the last day, this was our last day, my 80 to 400, it was so cold and it was snowing, that it froze. My zoom froze at about 200. So that's when I reached into my bag and I was able to pull out my 7000 that had the 24 to 120. And I was really happy that, because she's a mover. So when she was on that island, he told us what she was going to do and she did it. And I was really, really happy to have my third camera. The bigger guys, Stanley and Watson, and it's nice to have names for them, but they name them so they're able to say and know which bear. They don't want to do bear one, bear two, bear three, but it's really for identification purposes. And so they would know where and when these bears were in certain areas. But he was pretty intimidating, walking straight towards us. As you can see, I'm only shooting with the 80 to 400, and he wasn't that far away. This again was Sophie running towards us. She came up probably about 4 feet from our guide, and our guide just looked at her and he said, "Sophie, what are you doing?" And she was like, "Oh," because it was like she was surprised we were there. "Hello," and then she walked off. It was amazing. This is Watson, and he gave us a couple of beautiful photographic moments. I only saw him on our first day, and then did not see him again. But again, very relaxed around us and didn't have much interest in what we were doing as long as we didn't move, and gave us a lot of opportunity to photograph him fishing and hunting these salmon. And it was even fun to watch the salmon. When you weren't watching the bears, you could watch the salmon in the waters how they would pop up and the colors and seeing the new fish and how they hunt is remarkable. And you could tell that guys, the old guys, they take their time, you know? Stanley walks in there, he looks down, he sees the fish and he grabs it. All the younger bears are like, you know, my 8-year-old son, running all over the place and pounding the water and trying to get at the fish. But these guys are seasoned and they know exactly what they're doing. Here he is fishing. Sometimes they would get salmon, sometimes they wouldn't. And of course you want them to be coming in your direction. It didn't happen very often. A lot of times it was off to the side. But when they did pounce and come forward towards us, it was pretty cool. So this was when I laughed so hard the night that I went into the cabin, because I was with these guys from the States and they didn't really want to see my images. They didn't really care. And they were very private. And I just started howling because I looked at this and went, well, I may have had too much lens, but you know what? It worked. And when you see the face of that salmon going, oh, if you're having a bad day, all you have to do is think about that salmon. So it was pretty fun to be able to show it and say, okay, well, maybe I had too much lens, but I think it worked in this instance. She came out of nowhere and went fishing right in front of us. So that's full frame. So you can imagine she was pretty close. We had snow most of the day, which made, obviously, shooting not so easy. It was not light until about 10:30, 11 o'clock in the morning. So, some of the light we were starting with was really, really low. In fact, I went up to 5,000 ISO. I show some of my settings there so you can see the higher ISOs that I was using. And I was quite comfortable with the D4S going up to 5,000. I was still, you know, that, oh my goodness, I can't believe that I can actually shoot at 5,000. I needed, you know, at least 1,000 shutter speed. And that's what I was limited to. Snow, I started using these lens coats. Does anyone use lens coats? No, it's an American company. Wonderful, aren't they? Rainproof, waterproof, and it fits nicely over, you can order it for any lens that you might have. And it's an amazing, amazing piece because you're not bulked up and it's just easy access to all your camera, and you don't have to fiddle through arms. And I've tried many different companies, and I'm really happy with that. So the lens coats were really helpful, obviously, with the snowy conditions, but very, very tough. So when the sun did come out or it peeked through, we had some pretty magical light, and I can't believe that Sophie would create this massive shadow from her walk, and very, very warm, beautiful light at the end of the day that we were able to use. And it just changed everything. It was a game changer for shooting. This was our last morning when it was minus 21, and then all of a sudden now you've got the mist. So you've got the mist, and if it's not working in your image, then your image just looks like it's out of focus. So we had, it was so cold. I can't tell you, it was just so cold. I guess I'm not acclimatized to the minus 21 yet, but we had mist, and it was snowing off of the trees. Every time you put your face up to your camera, it froze. The lens froze. We were able to keep our cameras. We were in cabins, but they were heated by stove at night. So at the end of the day, we were able to take our cameras back and put them in our cabins, and it had a slow transition back to the warm. I put my face up to my camera, the back of my camera, and it had frost on it. So it's just, you know, one thing after another, and just praying that you're in focus or you that you've got something, because when it happens so quickly, as you know, if you're photographing wildlife. And then when you're not photographing wildlife, there were plenty of opportunities to photograph the beautiful landscape. Has anyone been up to the Yukon? This is the Arctic Circle over here. It is beautiful. I've only been there once before, and it was very brief. We were coming from Alaska, and it is extraordinary. And Dawson City, let me tell you, what a place. It's like going right back into the Gold Rush times. And if you want photo opportunities, go to Dawson City. Just don't go in July and August because there's too many tourists. But, oh, my goodness, it was like we were in Universal Studios. And the people, we met Caveman Bill, and we kissed the sour toe by our sour toe captain, Terry Lee. Has anyone heard about that story, the sour toe? Anyway, yeah, I did it. I kissed a dead toe. Anyway, see the fun that you can have when you're on these journeys, right? You never know. And going back, this is my last slide from this trip, and going back and being in the air, in a helicopter over the Yukon, was absolutely, unbelievably beautiful. and the sun had just peaked out a little bit. It was cloudy, and it was very, very neat to be able to photograph the caribou migration. We saw thousands and thousands of the porcupine herd, and then to be able to capture that little snippet of color in the right-hand corner, it was pretty neat. So I think I have the luckiest job in the world, the best job in the world. And as photographers, I'm sure you feel the same. Very, very fortunate to be able to photograph and experience Canada the way that I have. As I mentioned earlier, my dream of going to the Arctic came true about 8 years ago, and it really transformed the way that I photographed. It transformed my career. It's been a long road, but I have been to the Arctic many times now, and many times I'm called upon for Arctic images, and I am now known as the Arctic photographer, one of them anyway. We have some amazing Arctic photographers in Canada. This was my first trip that I had taken, and flying over Pond Inlet, which is way up above the Arctic Circle on the top of Baffin Island. Extraordinary place. Got Bylot Island on the other side, full of mountains and wonder. It was just amazing. And this teeny tiny community that's only fly in. It's the only possible way that you can go in. And what our trip was, we were going out to the flow edge. So the flow edge is where you go out on the ice, and the ice where it ends and the open water begins. So the next stop is Greenland, and that's where all the animals are. It's spring breakup, so all the animals are coming to you. Well, you hope they're coming to you. They don't always come to you, as we know. The polar bears, we have narwhal, beluga, bowhead whales, seals, walrus, birds. There's a bird cliff with millions of birds. It's pretty amazing. I thought I was out of my mind when I actually went on this trip, because we were tootling along on the ice, and then we had come across these cracks. This is an aerial, so you can look down. And as the spring breakup happens, the ice is pushed off, so it breaks up. But somehow you have to cross those cracks. How do you do that? We're in a komatik, and pulled by a skidoo. So either the Inuit guide will cross and jump the crack without you, or else he'll pull you across after. So he'll either jump it with you attached, or else jump and then pull you across. So at this point, I thought, I've completely lost my mind. I cannot believe that I'm doing this, and going out to the end of the ice, to camp on the ice for 7 days, mind you. But when I got out there and I realized what was there, I had not really known very much about the Arctic, and I was so pleasantly surprised and in wonder of the people, of the Inuit, of the landscape, and of the wildlife. And there are no barriers, there are no walls, there are no, you can't cross here. And to sleep out in a tent on the ice, knowing that there's polar bears and animals around you, but to also stand there and just in silence and just be there with the animals, it was way more than photography at that point, because it was about the experience and about being able to be quiet and to allow those animals to come to us. As we are down here, we're busy and we're in cars and we're in meetings and we're in traffic and we're in noise. There, you're in complete silence, just waiting for these animals to approach. It was pretty remarkable. And this was taken with the D1X. It was my first digital camera that I had taken up there. And I was so thrilled to see this narwhal. I had no idea even that I got the reflection. I was just so enamored that this beautiful whale was so close to me that it was a wonderful surprise to be able to see the reflection that I got underneath. This was what it looks like from another vantage point. When we were up there again on another trip up in Arctic Bay, I was so worried because the ice had come in and I thought we were going to be blocked. I thought the bears had gone out. There's going to be no access to the whales. But what happened was the pack ice had come in, and with the current had moved a little bit back out, and it created these beautiful pools. So you'd be sitting there, and as you can see, you're not on it's about 2 feet of ice. And all of a sudden, 40, 50 narwhal would come in front of you, and just they were just everywhere. And watching their behavior and trying to figure out what they were going to do next, they were coming right underneath us. They would all come up and at the same time, and then one would go down. And so one of the things with wildlife, and what I discovered with the with the grizzlies is watching the behavior. And if you have the time and you're lucky enough to spend with the animals, you're able to watch the behavior and anticipate what they might do next. And so you're on your toes for a lot of the time. You were happy when they went because you could actually breathe and look at the back of your camera and see what you've been able to capture. So it's pretty intense shooting, but fortunately they do go away and come back. So you have that time to recoup. So friends of mine were going into the water. I thought they were absolutely out of their minds. And they were going in to photograph the narwhal. So they did have an extra dry suit, and I thought, you know, take yourself completely out of your comfort zone and do something you never thought you would do. So I did. I went in, and I got in the water with the narwhal. And, of course, when I was putting on the dry suit, I had never had the dry suit on and put the head over, and I couldn't believe why I was doing this. And so there were narwhal there, and then I jumped in the water, and all the narwhal left. It was that break I was talking about. And so then I'm in the water, and I'm thinking, oh, this is cool. I couldn't see anything except for just this beautiful ocean. I was hoping that I wasn't going to see a walrus underneath me. But it was just mind-blowing that I was actually doing this, and I was there. So all my guides and the other fellow photographers were on the ice, and they would go, Michelle, there's... And so I would put my head down because I was only snorkeling. But I had wet hands and wet head, so I got cold very quickly. But my body was warm. My hands and my head got cold. So finally, my guide said, Michelle, there's a narwhal. So I put my head under, and he came underneath me, and he stopped. And he just stared at me, which felt like seconds or minutes, but it probably was only half a second. But he turned upside down just to look at me, probably hoping that I was a seal. Somebody asked me why I wore dark dry suit. I was like, why do you ask that? He said, well, don't you think you look like a seal? Oh, next time I'll wear a red one. And then I turned back and I saw six more glide right underneath me. And then that was it. I lasted 52 minutes, but after that I had to get in. I was just way too cold and I couldn't handle it anymore. And I vowed to get in again, but unfortunately the weather turned and we weren't able to. But this June coming up, I'm heading back to Pond Inlet, and I sure hope that I have another opportunity to get in and experience this wonderful, beautiful creature. Walrus, I spoke about walrus. They're dangerous animals in the water. You don't ever, well, I know there's a couple of videographers and photographers that get in the water with them, but I'll get in the water with a narwhal. I'll never get in the water with walrus. I had gone to this island to photograph the walrus. And let me just say, they smell way... They smell so bad. It's not even believable. When your guide is putting, you know, when your guide is hiding, your Inuit guide is hiding his nose, you know it smells bad. But it was an amazing sight to see these 10,000 walrus blanket this island. And we had this perfect little perch. It wasn't too high up on this cliff, and we had a wonderful view, wonderful vantage point of the walrus below. And it was very interesting to watch the behavior and watch these little guys that, hard to believe that they're not trampled by the 25-pounders. But somehow they all manage, and the males get up, and they start fighting each other, and it's like, just move over. There's room on the beach. It's amazing to watch. And so my guide, I said, okay, we're good. Can we walk down to their level before we leave? And I was a little worried about going that close to this massive herd of walrus. So we walked up in our camouflage. I'm sure he didn't see us coming. It took us a while to walk up to him. But nothing was working for me. Like, it was pretty, you know, the light was blah. It was 4 o'clock. It was going down. It was behind clouds. And it was really just a blanket. And there was no real definition. There was no interest. It was just a blanket. I had this nice cliff beside me. So I did some close-up work, and this guy and I were talking to each other with our eyes, you know, okay, we're not here to hurt you. You're not going to hurt us, right? And it was really, really beautiful to spend time this close to this this wonderfully beautiful, not so much creature, hey? the skin, the textures, and everything. So at that point, I said, okay, let's turn back. and let's go back. And as we turned, we were walking away, and this thunderous sound happened, and I was hand-holding my 200 to 400, and I just turned around and started shooting. But what I didn't expect, that they were all on the move. Something had spooked them, and they were all going into the water. And I just started shooting. My instinct was just shoot whatever you can. I didn't even really know what I was shooting because it happened so quick. I didn't know what my exposures were. I didn't know anything. And I was hand-holding the 200 to 400. And when I looked at the back of the camera, I knew that I had my shot. And nobody else, there's not anyone else in the world that's going to ever have this shot. And I think that's what we're all looking for, you know, and that we're waiting for. And you capture that moment that it's just so surreal and you're so proud of. When you're shooting so many images, to be able to find that one or two that you're able to get, it's a wonderful thing. So the sandstone from the sand from the stone underneath them created the mist, and then the sun just peeked out. The sun was not out. The sun peeked out, and now I had depth and I had mystery and I had a story with this image. So fortunately for me, I've won a couple of awards and it's been used in Nikon's advertising as well. So very, very happy about that image. This was up in Wapusk National Park, which is just below Churchill. And again, as Canada, it's the only place, the only known denning place of the polar bears that you can actually go and see. And in this area, the mothers will den in this area. And this company will take you out in these buggies, and you spend the day waiting for a polar bear to emerge from her den with her cubs. And it does happen, and it happens there, and it only happens there in Canada. It's remarkable. So they have these buggies. As you can see, there were a lot of photographers, but it was minus 50 with the wind. Minus 50. So we were all excited because right first off, the first day it was blue skies, it was amazing weather, it was windy, but we spotted the mom and cubs. So this was, we all got out, we all set up our cameras, and then this was like 10 minutes later. It was pretty cold. It was pretty cold. So once we were out, you had to leave your cameras out. We'd take our batteries, put them in our pockets, and get warm. But that first day when we were watching that mother and her cubs, oh, there you can see how cold it is. His tear froze. we were first with this mom and two cubs, we were watching her play. And again, it was a decision. Do you have the 600 with the two times, or do you just go with the 600? And I had decided to put the two times on after I had gone out, and just to get a little bit more reach because she was so far away. And we were watching her for about an hour, and then she just got up, she smelled the air, and then she just beelined it right for us. Not fast, she was very controlled, and our guides went in with the skidoos and the guns in between us and her, and stopped her from coming any closer. She got about 90 feet, but this is, again, full frame, so... you know, this is when you go, oh, this is great. But anyway, I love this shot. I love the cubs are behind and slightly out of focus. But they did provide us with some great photo ops, even running away from mom, which we didn't want her to do. She was, they went off. They were like, hey, what's over there? Let's go look. And we're all like, no, go back to mom. Go back to mom. Don't come any closer. Very, very, very cool to be able to watch the behavior of the cubs with their mother, and how wonderful polar bears are as mothers. And watching this cub, she had two cubs. This is another mother. She had two cubs, and it looked to us like she was struggling to feed this one. The other one didn't look like it had any trouble, but it was really struggling. And she spent a lot of time trying to bring the cub in and to feed him. And interestingly enough, she sat under the only tree in the whole area. but you know, it just became again a lot more than just the photography. It was the experience, and I felt so fortunate to be able to be there and looking and watching these animals in their own habitat, and just being so fortunate, as I said, to be there. As you can tell, I'm just so lucky. I feel so blessed every time that I'm able to experience this. So I did shoot a little video that I'll show you it gives you the idea of what it's like. I think when you play the video or when you're capturing the video, it's hard to turn off, like, okay, so should I be videotaping or should I be taking pictures? And then you start taking pictures, and you're like, this would be really good in video. So then you start doing video, and then you're like, but this is going to be really good in pictures. So, you know, finding that balance of when you're ready to do the video, if you have the opportunity, it's wonderful because it's a great compliment to your work. Think that looks cold? I can't wait. I'm going back with the D4S, so I'm armed and ready for more polar bears. I haven't photographed them in a while, but I have spent a lot of times with polar bears, a lot of time photographing them in many different places in the Arctic. And this was one trip that I took with my girlfriend, and I had an opportunity to go up before the real clients were going up, I had a chance to go up and check it out. And so I asked my friend to come, and she said that she had always wanted to join me on one of my adventures and see the polar bears. So we took this little prop plane, beaver or an otter. Anyway, we landed on the tundra, and as we were flying around the camp on our approach, you could see a bear on the sand, on the beach, not very far away. So when we landed, we were taking stuff out, and I always, like I said, I like to have the option of having two cameras with two lenses, and this is when I was really glad that I did. So I had taken up the 500 with me, and I was trying to pull it out. I had kind of stuffed it in the 200 to 400 bag, so it was easier to carry. And again, I had a friend who wasn't a photographer, so I could use her for for her equipment, for equipment hands. And I was trying to pull it out, and she's like, Michelle, there's a bear. And I said, yeah, I know there's a bear. And she goes, no, there's a bear. And I said, yes, there's a bear. She said, the bear is there. And I looked, and the bear was right there, and very, very curious about us. And I had gotten my 500 on and got off a couple of images. But this was when it's like, can you back up just a little bit? You're a little close. But I did have my 24-120 on. And before I knew it, the bear approached and kept approaching. And before I knew it, I was standing behind my guide, and the bear was only feet in front of him. And he was talking Inuktitut to the bear, saying, big bear, don't come closer, get back. You know, we don't want to hurt you. We don't want you to hurt us. And he, full Inuktitut. It was like the bear was listening. My girlfriend was in a doorway. I didn't even know how she got there. I just knew that I couldn't move. I knew if I moved, this was not going to end pretty. So I took pictures, because what else am I going to do? I'm watching him take pictures or talk to this polar bear, and I had just landed. I had no idea. And anyway, this bear sat down, and, you know, big fat bear sits down, and my girlfriend's like, oh, cute, you know, big fat bear. And then the guide says, are you done taking photos? I'm like, yeah. And he says, yeah, the bear's going to charge. I'm like, you're not waiting for me, are you? So he had to fire a ground shot, and the bear did back off, fortunately. So there was nothing that was interfered with, or there was no casualty or anything like that, which is, of course, the last thing that you want to happen when you're out in the field and you're in their environment. To disrupt them is what we're doing. We don't want to cause any harm by any means. But it was quite interesting to spend time in those cabins, and we had bears everywhere. So any time that we opened up our door, we had to call for our guide to make sure there was no bear around. So imagine, I'm a portrait wedding photographer in Ottawa years before this. So my life has drastically changed, let's just say, and all for the better. I had another opportunity to be they called me a celebrity photographer. I said, you could call me anything you want to call me, as long as I get to be a part of this expedition. And we went up to Arctic Bay. We were supposed to go out to the floe edge, but the floe edge was unmanageable to get to. And this family wanted the ultimate Arctic vacation, and I got to be a part of it. So we landed on the ice in the Beaver, and we had the family's tent were the ones up on the left, and the bottom ones were the staff cabins. And that iceberg is what we got to look at every day when we walked out. And we got to fly around the Arctic because they hired two helicopters, because that's what you do when you're in the Arctic, right? You just get two helicopters at your disposal. So we'd fly everywhere, and we flew up into fjords. We flew out to the floe edge. We saw things from the air, which was really amazing, because I had been experiencing them all from the ground. And to be able to have this vantage point and to be that lucky to see it from above was pretty cool. Even, and I shoot through the windows. I was in the front, so I wasn't able to open up any windows in the back. But that caribou shot that I showed you earlier was also photographed right through the window. So I take the opportunities when I can, and I try to find that right spot in the window that you can photograph through. And as I said, that this was our view, the icebergs. But fortunately for me, there was a hot air balloon and a hot air balloon pilot with us, because that's what you do in the Arctic, right? When you don't have the helicopters, you have a hot air balloon. But this hot air balloon, it took 9 days for it to fly. So our pilot was pretty anxious to get it in the air. We finally had the calm winds, this beautiful sky, and he told me he was going to launch it from the right side of the balloon, from the bergs, and then he said, well, what would you like me to do? And I said, well, if you could fly it between the bergs, that would be really great. And he did. So it was pretty extraordinary. It took 9 days to get this image. But when I did get it and I showed it to him after, he said, you know what you got, eh? And I said, yeah, I got a photo of a hot air balloon between two icebergs. And he says, no, but do you know what you've got? So I posted it on Nat Geo. I entered it into the Travelers Contest, and I got the top 10 image, and it went viral. And for me, it was great, because I ended up getting an email from somebody from an ad agency in New York saying, do you sell your work? Which is always a really funny question to any photographer. No, 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 no. No, I don't sell my work. And so she told me that she had a client, and it ended up being in this advertisement. They bought the rights for 5 years, and it's for the Ritz-Carlton Reward Program. So I was pretty excited about that, because they have the budget, let's just say, right? And then Nat Geo just released this new book called Rarely Seen, Places of the Extraordinary, and they called me to tell me that they were putting it on the back cover. So I'm pretty happy about that. They don't pay quite as well as the ad agency, let's just say, but pretty cool for me. So I'm just going to warm it up a little bit, and then I can take any questions that you might have. I have a few other stories to share, but I'll try to talk a little bit through them, not so many stories behind, but get you some images that you can see. Has anyone gone down to Silverbank to photograph the humpbacks or swim with the humpbacks? So I thought I was crazy swimming with narwhal. Now I'm swimming with humpbacks. That's me on the bottom left side. So there's this area that you can go to that they have these migrating humpbacks. And there's a couple of companies that run these tours. And you can actually get in the water and swim with humpback whales. And literally, you're from me to you. You're that close to them. And yeah, it just kind of changed my perspective of what it's like to be in the water with humpback whales. When you're seeing them on the surface, and if they're very quiet, really what they're doing is coming up to breathe and going down and sleeping. So they turn off half their brain, and they're just like 30 feet below. For me, when I saw them on the top of the surface, if they went under, I just thought that they kept going. But they're really just below the surface. So that's when you're able to get in the water with them. And when they're calm, you're able to get in. And the guide goes over, finds them, puts up his hand. You jump in. And this was a calf. It was only 4 weeks old. And this was our first minute in the water. And I was with a few other people. But I know he came up to see me. No one else. He left his mom and then just came swimming right to us and then took a line back to her. But it was just so mind-blowing and freaky, because I just had no idea what to expect, and it was kind of intimidating to get in the water with these massive creatures. This was one I didn't get a lot of images from the first trip that I did with the humpbacks, but this is one that I just absolutely loved and I worked really hard for. I had these terrible flippers, and there's a long story on that I won't get into, but he was a migrated, he'd just come down, he was a juvenile, and you could still see the cold water barnacles underneath him, and he was just flopping around and he was turning. And again, I was just trying to stay out of the way of his pictorial, and I didn't know until after that I actually got that bubble stream from his pictorial. This was last year, so you can imagine I'm shooting with a 14 mil, so you can imagine how, and this is full frame, how close you actually are, especially when you can't get the full whale in your shot. So as much as you have underwater experience, you have some amazing topside experience as well, which again provides a whole different, an opposite scenario to being down, being up in the north. You know, you have to transition your cameras from the cold to the warm. Here, you have to transition your cameras from the cold to warm, but you're in air conditioning and then you're going out into humidity. So a couple of times we had some fogging issues just because of the transition was so quick. But when you're in the tender and you've got all this action happening and the whales are very close, you've got spray from the whales, you've got spray from the boat, and you've got a lot of things happening at the same time. And fortunately for me, for this image, my camera was up. It came out of nowhere. So always being ready and ready with your cameras is obviously key. But fun to watch, and just imagine that much water from a flip from the tail. So you're getting topside and you're getting underwater experience, and it's pretty remarkable, especially when you've got beautiful light like you can. So Sable Island, does anyone know where Sable Island is? I'm back to Canada. Sable Island is a small crescent island off of Nova Scotia. It has 580, they estimate, wild horses. And again, it's a very difficult place to get to, but Adventure Canada does have a tour there in June going back. We were the first passenger cruise ship that were allowed onto the island. And I had, the 800 had just come out from Nikon, and I had said to the VP, I said, well, I think I should take the 800 to Sable, because I don't think those wild horses are going to come running to me. And when we got there, I set up and I was ready to go, and I had four horses walk right to me. So again, just a little bit too much lens for when they approached and got too close, but it gave me a really neat perspective and something very different from what everybody else was shooting as well. And to get some details, to get some close-ups. And, you know, it was very, very neat to be able to look at these horses and watch them that close. And I was really happy. It was just very difficult to carry an 800 with a tripod, especially when you're walking up sand dunes. But these horses, they're not interfered by humans whatsoever. There's no human interference, so they really, they look at you blankly. They don't really, there's no threat to them. There's no threat to you. They just keep going. They're interested in rubbing. So at one point, I had my camera and tripod, and they came up, and I was told by the parks guy that I might want to get my camera because he'll think it's something to rub on. That wouldn't have been really fun for Nikon, eh? Going back, well, you know, these are jellyfish. Again, taking the 800 and seeing things a little bit differently. They're teeny, teeny, tiny comb jellyfish that were on the beach. Even photographing, they don't have a lot of water on the island, but the ponds that they do have had some lily pads, gave us a different perspective. Even looking at a mushroom. That's why I don't eat mushrooms. You're not laughing. A lot of the shooting that I do is through zodiacs. In zodiacs, very difficult. You're in the moving boats, you've got moving subjects, and you've got other people likely in the boat. When I'm resource photographer, I'm teaching while I'm on board, and then also when we're out in the zodiac. So we're working it, and there's a lot of things happening. There's constantly other boats as well, other zodiacs around. So this was still on Sable Island and photographing these guys. It was at quite a distance, but it was really neat to be able to watch the whole takedown that the male was having with the two males were having. They were fighting over that herd in the back, and it was really, really neat to watch. So polar bears, again, keeping steady, making sure that you have a good enough shutter speed that you're able to handhold and capture the motion. This was just in September. And these black-legged kittiwakes were eating the cod, Arctic cod. And they had been at a distance, and then all of a sudden, you know, they kept coming closer and closer. And things were happening so quick, I didn't even see the fish. I was just focusing on trying to figure out where I was going to shoot, and it wasn't until after. I've been lucky enough to visit Antarctica, photographing porpoising penguins in a zodiac with a lot of waves is not easy, let me just say. And there were a lot of mistakes that I made to get this image, but they were pretty fun to try. You could see the roughness of the water. It was pretty wild. But there's two different kinds of penguins in this shot. It's an Adelie and Gentoo. And as well, we had a pod of orcas. They were there for a second, and then they were gone. There were about five of them. They showed up. They swam by our boat. I shot. I didn't even know if I was in focus. I just took my chances and was happy to see that there was a little calf underneath. An albatross taking a picture of the macaroni penguins. Beautiful, beautiful landscape. Have people gone to Antarctica or South Georgia here? Another place that you'll not run out of things to photograph, let me just say. This was a trip I did in June to Kutsumitin, and it's in British Columbia, and it's a bear sanctuary. And you're out in zodiacs all day. So you have a mothership that you stay on, and then each day you go out. And again, you have pretty interesting conditions that you have to work with. You're in a zodiac. You could have a lot of rain there in the mountains. And these bears aren't eating. They're just eating on sedge. There's no salmon. So it was a pretty neat experience to watch these grizzlies and to be very, very close. The only difference is, of course, that you're not on land. You're in a zodiac. So you can back up pretty quick. But they swim right to you. And when I was watching them, they would put their heads down in the water and smell out, they're saying, you know, other scents of other bears. And when the bear would come up, he would breathe out, and I would see these bubbles. So I made it my mission to get these bubbles. And it's the only shot that I got, and I tried it many times just to get that right moment of when he came up and he just happened to look at me, thank goodness. The moms and the cubs, you don't get too close with the moms and the cubs. They won't let you. They'll just take off. The mom's pretty protective. But we were able to spend about an hour to 2 hours just with this family that was down by the water. And aren't they not the cutest? And so different. Each one of them are so different. And this was our last day, and it just started to rain a little bit, and this grizzly came out of the water and walked up to this tree stump. And even our guide was so happy because he's like, he's going to climb that tree. He's going to lie down. And he lied down there like he was just having a nice little cozy nap. And again, having multiple lenses and being able to switch off between the two cameras, I took this one for my son. I came home and I said, this one's for you. And you can't really see it, but in the background, there's a little bit of rain falling. So I just, it's one of my favorite, all-time favorite photos. Talking about perspective and you know, I go between having the long lens and the short lens, and I love to be able to show the animal in their environment, like most of you probably, and I love to get up close and personal as well to show character and texture of their fur and their eyes. But you know, switching off and being able to have a zoom or to have the two cameras, if you can't have the two cameras, to be able to play off so you're able to show the animal in their environment. I'm sure you all do that. It's a struggle sometimes because you want to get in close, but you also want to show. But when you do and you are able to show the beauty of the surroundings, then it's a wonderful way to represent the animal. Even in landscapes, this was an iceberg, and it was beautiful on its own, but getting in closer and closer and then going in really tight and getting the textures and the colors and the patterns made all the difference in the image. Again, showing the animal, these are humpbacks up in Greenland, and this is a humpback down in Antarctica. So being able to put that tail into the icebergs, it changes the image completely, don't you think? Giving it perspective and showing where the whale is. The penguins, there's 250,000 penguins on Salisbury Plain. 250,000 penguins. What do you do with that? And fur seals. And it's hard to know where to start and how to represent them. And it's almost so intimidating because you're shooting so much because you think that you have to. But if you take your time and you look and you really immerse yourself in the surroundings, and then I tried to show the landscape with the images, but then I also tried to isolate and show the penguins outside of the 250,000, you know, to get up close and personal with a small group, which was really fun. I spent an hour just sitting there with these five that were fighting over the female and very curious about me and what I was doing. And again, looking at the you know, the beautiful, beautiful landscape of South Georgia, and then being able to isolate and go in tight. Look at that guy. Don't you feel sorry for him? It's a one-year-old who's just about to molt, and he's called a yokum. And just the funniest creatures. Gosh, they look so funny with their fur coats. Again, it's, you know, showing the perspective of where we came across this leopard seal. And he was just sleeping. He wasn't doing much action, but it was really cool to be able to look and see the icebergs around him and try to show the landscape of where he was, to show the environment, and then to go in a little bit tighter when he did wake up and yawn. He didn't give us much more than that, but I was happy to be in a little bit tighter when he did actually show his teeth. Imagine swimming with that. Mm. Again, just a little bit further out on the top image, going a little closer on the bottom, and just again isolating one penguin versus trying to photograph 250,000 at a time. Try to show the character. And okay, so this, I want to show you this video because it's the funniest thing, I think. Hopefully brighten your day. And the penguin in the front is the female, and it's the males in the back, the two males behind her that are fighting for her. And the one behind is just ready to go in and take charge, I think. Look at the guy in the back, he's just gonna... That's when I love doing video. I absolutely love it. So I think I'm probably... Yes, I'm a little bit over my time. I just wanted to mention that I do have some images that I printed. I'm using the new Epson P800. I don't know if you've gone over and seen it or if anybody has it. I also print a lot with the Hanamule fine art paper, and Phil's here. He was the one who got me hooked on this beautiful photoreg fine art paper. You're welcome to come and have a look, and I'll put some over in the Epson booth as well. But we're going to try to do a workshop. We're going to be talking about it today. So we can talk about paper. This will probably be in Ottawa to start. We'll talk paper, we'll talk printers, and how to get the best results out of your printer. So if you keep an eye out on my website or my social media, I'll be posting that when we move ahead with it. But I think, do you all print? Are you printers? It's tough, eh? When I printed these, I realized how I have my studio that prints for me, but I realize how little I print anymore. And it's just such a beautiful thing to be able to print out and see your images on paper. It's really amazing. So keep your eyes and ears posted for that if you're interested. And we'll probably start in Ottawa and then maybe come to Toronto. We're discussing that today. So thank you so much. If anyone has any questions, I'm happy to answer any questions you might have. And I'm here after, and I do have a few books if anyone's interested as well. So thank you so much for coming out.